Keith, how's everything on your end? What's going on the West Coast?
Oh, it's pretty good here. Been very wet. We'll get into that. Otherwise, it's normal for this time of year. It's just exceptional amount of rain we've been having.
Yeah, and Markus?
It's fall, you know. It's fall in Germany. It's the same we had last week. It's a great rainy. People are getting sicker and sicker, and business as usual here.
All right, and in New Jersey, we're dragging as usual, waiting for the Omicron to drop, I'm putting my booster shots on hold, as I don't know if it will have any effect whatsoever on the new strain. And we're in a holding pattern here. Anyway, we have a full show for you this week, but we have an announcement to make, and we have been thinking about how to develop the show or develop our presence. We seem to have had like a plateau in terms of audience and so forth, and we rethought our content. Markus, you want to expand on that?
Yes. As you guys know, that I'm pretty annoyed by this platform here, YouTube, for quite a long time now. Not only because the problems we experienced for years, you know, with blocking content when it comes to music. It is even worse, you know, when you experience that your content is getting blocked and censored and stuff. And I thought for a long time it would be time, you know, to move away from here. And last Sunday we met. A couple of days before, I talked to John, and as you know, John is producing KYRC radio, and we got into details finally, and we got an, if you want to say so, an offer from John we could not resist. You know, it is not about money that was
because there isn't any.
Of course not. It was, you know, we have the great opportunity to get that we can produce content for the morning hours, you know, the important time where the people are rushing to work, and they are usually listening to the radio when they're doing this. And I think this is the most important slot you can have on the radio today. And I think it would help us a lot if we can spread the information we want to give by this platform. You know, as I said, you know, we are seeing so many things on YouTube happening which we are not satisfied with anymore. So this is an absolute golden opportunity for us. And so we decided, we had a meeting last Sunday with John, as I said. We decided to change the formats. So you will ask, is this the end of No Joke? And are we completely away from YouTube? Or are we going away from anything to do with video information? No, it is not like that. And this can Amos explain maybe.
Yeah, so basically our focus is going to change. We're going to produce a show that is down the line. We're going to produce probably a live show, as we are with No Joke. We haven't decided what it's going to be called. It's going to be structured differently, and it's going to be much less visual. We're going to focus on the audio aspect of it, so it's radio ready. And like Markus said, that this opens us to a much wider demographic of listeners, podcast listeners as well, and not necessarily just progressives. It just basically opens us to local, rural audiences. And we think that it's an opportunity to expand our reach. At the same time, we love you guys. We've been with you for many years. Some of you even before I was on board, and so we want to keep everybody as part of that transition. Hopefully you will follow us. We're going to most likely have a little video announcement on the main page, on the Uphill Media channel page on YouTube, with a link as well, that you can follow us into the Mixed Cloud. That's going to be our platform, the Mixed Cloud platform. And over there, our advantage is that we can use our music royalty licenses to actually play music and make it much more like a flowing program rather than just talking heads. We hope you like that change.
Yes.
And again, we'd like to hear your input. Like, if you have ideas for a name for a future live show, or any thoughts that you may have, you can just tweet us and use the hashtag KORC, and so we will be able to address that and consider that.
Yes, and as Amos said, we are trying out what Mixcloud, another platform, has to offer. This platform is usually used by DJs, and it's normally a music platform, but it also offers a section which is about politics, and there we are, right? And as Amos said, we are free to play the music we want to play, and I think it will also help the flow of the shows. You will see that the future format will be a bit different from what you're used to. As Amos said, you know, until now you are used to three talking heads, you know, discussing about politics and stuff, you know. It would be a little bit different, because it would be a learning process for all three of us also, because doing this live and just starting to talk is a little bit different than preparing stuff and checking stuff and then record it and put it on the radio section, in the radio files, right? So we are going to learn also the differences between those kinds of working with media, and I think it also will change on how we will work in the future with our visual program, you know. And we still cannot say in what frequency we will have the video live shows on Mixcloud, but you will get definitely informed. You know, we also will leave a message, you know, from Uphill Media on YouTube, you know, that you can follow a link. And if you want to follow the live show, Amos, maybe if he can find the time, will also put out sections from the Mixcloud live shows and put them on YouTube. But we got to see how it is going to develop, because I made the first attempts, you know, with recorded stuff, you know, and I know that it is time consuming, you know, but I also know that is one we are getting familiar with, all the stuff around radio producing. We will get a better flow in it, you know, and so I think it is likely that in the beginning we will have a show maybe once a month, when it's going easy and good, maybe two times a month, but we will see. And maybe when we are completely into it, that we can go back to the old routine with the weekly shows. But of course, as I said, they would be in a different format. Keith, you didn't say anything so far. So what is your opinion on it?
Yeah, well, now it's my turn. Now I get to talk a lot. Okay, yeah, you know, we've covered everything pretty much. So this is an evolving thing, and the changes will, you know, not happen all at once, and we're not exactly sure how it's going to go. So, you know, keep tuning in every week, because we're not just going to vanish suddenly there'll be an announcement of where to go, get the new, where to get the new content and all that good stuff. So, the other thing I want to emphasize, Amos brought it up, is that, you know, here in chat, as the weeks go by and we try things out, maybe you can let us know and get involved in the process with us. So that's what I have to say.
Yes.
It's a great opportunity. We're looking forward to it. We actually have a pretty good idea of what we're doing, but it only has come at us in the last week. And so, like, trying to get, you know.
Yes, you got to see that we are still in the process of brainstorming, if you want. So, you know, we
right.
have John. We have
right
John
here in front us. Of you.
we have John with us, you know, who also gives us ideas, you know, on how to do this, because he's doing this a little while also. He is completely into it, you know. And as I said, it's a learning process and a big opportunity. And it doesn't only concern things when it comes to political stuff, environmental stuff, or others. It is also a fun aspect, you know. And as soon as we got the format planning and the routine in it, we also consider to do music live shows with John, you know, or maybe Keith can do something in infomercial about his socialistic party, he's the movement he's into, and Amos definitely will have good ideas, you know, he wants to talk in other formats maybe, and as I said, you know, it's an open country. And we just set foot on it to settle it, right? And it's wonderful, and we are thrilled, right?
Yeah.
Yes, we're thrilled.
Barbara, don't feel scared. We're a little bit scared because it's a new thing, but without trying new things and leaping into new terrains, we're not gonna grow. So. We're aware of that, and that's what we're doing. So don't feel like nervous about it,
And to answer your question, Barbara, John is not coming on today. It is not possible, you may think, but John hates YouTube even more than I do.
True. Very true.
Yes.
Yeah, and right. To remind this everybody, we're also, whatever is published on YouTube, whether we're going to republish things, segments to YouTube, which we may do, more likely are to do, it also appears in Odyssey, so you can, if you like Odyssey better, you can subscribe to it there.
Yes, and KORCFM is live, right? So, don't miss the chance, you know, when we have finished the show, you know, you can go directly to KORCFM 105.9 and listen what's going on there. You will find a lot of music there, different music. Sometimes the music collection is strange, but also kind of creative if you want. So, but as I said, you know, it is an open field and we are working on it. And it's where we see our future.
Yeah. So all right. So we have a regular program prepared for you today. Do you want to launch into our first
talk? Sure. Let's do that. Let's just throw on slide 7, but don't start it yet. Just let me talk. And when I see it, I'll start talking. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I asked Amos and Markus, you know, hey, what's causing the inflation? You know, all the prices are going up. And they both said supply chain. And that was the end of that. And we had to go on. It was pretty close to the end of the show, I think. And that was that. That got me thinking, what's going on with inflation? Because last month, well, you know, the month of October was very, very high in inflation. It's too soon to know what's going on with November yet. But anyway, I decided to look into the inflation issue more, and I found a few things out interesting. And the first thing I started with was I'm kind of a fan of Left of Left and James from the Internet. And so he had this Why Corporations Cry About Pandemic Inflation. When Well, what he's claiming is that they're really just taking profits, and the idea that the supply chain is causing it is bullshit. And so I decided, he puts that out, and I decided I'd investigate that on myself. So I went out and read some articles and prepared a few slides and got some information to talk about. And I wasn't even going to show James. You know, he was a launching point for my segment, and I found the other material. But at the end, I decided to throw him on top and give him in the first 2 minutes so he can kind of introduce what this is all about. And from that, I'll make sure the question that we want to answer is posed. So go ahead and play it, Amos.
Hello, greetings, everybody. My name is James. I am from the internet. And today we are going to be talking about opportunity. Nah! A long time ago, somebody a lot wiser and a lot more intelligent than myself coined the phrase, never let a good opportunity go to waste. And over the last 2 years, as the pandemic has made everything unstable, including workforces, economies, supply chains, well, all of that chaos has provided ample opportunity for those who have the resources and the ability to capitalize upon it. Now, the flip side of somebody taking advantage of an opportunity and doing well for themselves is that it usually ends up fucking over a whole lot of other people. So what I would like to do today is take a look at some of those people who got absolutely screwed by other people, companies, corporations, and plutocrats taking advantage of some opportunity, and then I want to explain to you how, even though everything is, quote, going back to normal, well, those opportunists are still out there, and they're still taking advantage of this whole situation. And by this whole situation, I mean they're taking advantage of you. All right, here we go. I can't even afford to buy a cart of groceries. Spiraling inflation leaves some grocery workers struggling. The gap between hourly wages and the cost of food means that many grocery workers often face the daily experience of being around food they can't afford. Now, as fucking horrible and hideous as this title is, I do have to take a moment and point out two things. Number one, inflation. I believe we have kicked the bullshit of this particular trope around for the better part of the last month. I've done a crap ton of videos on it, and if those weren't enough, please feel free to peruse the Act TV video section. I believe that Juliana.
Okay, Florano, I think we're supposed to stop it now. It should have stopped.
Professor Richard Wolf the other day.
There we go. Yeah. Oh, he did mention that. I did watch the Richard Wolf video. Very good. Okay. So that introduces the point I wanted to explore is the inflation coming as a result of genuine, you know, need because of their real genuine supply chain issues? Or what the hell is going on? Are profiteers just marking prices up because they can? And so I decided I would explore this. The rest, you know, James has got about 12 more minutes of video, but he doesn't have a lot of evidence in there, and a lot of opinion. All of it I agree with, but that's not the point. I wanted to really look into this then. So the first thing, what's inflation? You know, it's how much is the cost of living going up? Very simple, should be easy as hell to measure. And it turns out, well, now I do get to expound a little bit on the socialism aspect of things here. And yeah, we live in a capitalist society and everything's determined by markets. And so the one thing I learned was that, you know, there's this thing called supply and demand. And as the demand goes up, so does the cost. If the supply goes down, you know, it's related to the supply and demand that sets prices, and that's the market. And well, so that's only true in a capitalist system. You know, if you had a socialist system, you might have something called central planning, and that would set prices in an altogether different way. Actually more efficient, but you know, that's not the purpose to talk about that today. But my purpose in bringing that up is to point out inflation only means something under our current system. And you know, just this little bit of investigation made me realize that you know, contemporary economics, like from the American point of view, it's only written around one model, you know, capitalism. And so, you know, I'm being pretty verbose here, but this is a really interesting thing because I found out I was paying far too much attention to what inflation is, like it's really something. And no, it turns out to just be a measure of market activity, and it really doesn't mean a lot, but you know, that's getting ahead of things. So I'm trying to find out about inflation. I'm reading about experts that are telling me it's going to go up for two more years, and other experts telling me no, it's over with, and they're citing all sorts of different statistics to bear out whatever the hell they want to say. And so the first thing is, like, what is inflation? And then, you know, in October it went up 6.2%, and that's according to the generally well-known CPI index, but there are others. Let's go on to the next slide. Like, this is a popular one right now. It's the cost of Christmas. You know, on the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, da-da-da-da-da, you know, and you get the 12 things, and like, how much of those, like five gold rings, the cost of five gold rings went up 8.5%. And they didn't do this, they did it relative to 2019, because last year was all screwed up because of the pandemic, like this year's not. But anyway, so what we, by this measure, there's this 5.4% increase in inflation. And, you know, there's another interesting measure of inflation called the Big Mac Index, and that went up 5.1%. Let's go on to the next slide, and we can see that. And we can even play a short little video. It's just fun to watch. And yeah, you see.
Surprising is that Israel is among the biggest Mac index ones. And
well, a lot of Americans go to Israel, I guess. That would make sense to me. Yeah, what that is was, you know, all those countries, and in every country they sell a Big Mac, so they can keep track of the price of the Big Macs and come up with an
talking
index.
About capitalism, right?
Yeah, that's right. You know. How much is this? How much do the pickles cost? Right. And so finally, you know, let's look at the next slide. And this is kind of the gem. And we're going to play it. Right away, the word Santa Claus comes up. And I almost wanted to stop it right there, but there was more to play. And it's too much fun. Just start playing that thing.
And FedEx, which are on track to deliver more packages than ever. Now, I can't promise that every person will get every gift they want on time. Only Santa Claus can keep that promise. But there are items every year that sell out that are hard to find. Some of you moms and dads may remember Cabbage Patch Kids back in the 80s, or Beanie Babies in the 90s, or other toys that have run out at Christmas time in past years when there was no supply chain problem. But we're heading into a holiday season in very strong shape. It's not because of luck. We averted potential crisis by figuring out what needed to get fixed, and then we brought people together to do the hard work of fixing it. That's exactly what we're doing with the second concern I want to talk about today, prices. Here are a few things you should know. Just about every country in the world is grappling with higher prices right now as they recover from the pandemic. In the United Kingdom, price increases have hit a 10-year high. In Germany, a 28-year high. In Canada, price increases are the highest they've been since the 90s. This is a worldwide challenge, a natural byproduct of a world economy shut down by the pandemic as it comes back to life. Prices are still out of sync as the world comes back. But as we continue to overcome these obstacles, the more price pressures will ease. But I have not been content to sit back and wait. I've used every tool available to address the price increases, and it's working. Take gas prices. Last week, I announced the largest ever release from the United States Strategic Petroleum Reserve to increase the supply of oil and help bring down prices.
That'll fix things. Whoa. Yeah. Well, you know, everybody, resting away with Biden is better than burning down with Trump. Don't forget that. Yeah.
He's denying there is a delivery crisis and stuff, right? Did I understand it right?
Correct. Yeah, there's this month, they're claiming in November so far, they're claiming that, oh, no, the inflation's gone. You know, everything's fixed. You know, and okay. Last month they were saying, oh, no, this is going to go on. This is the first month of a two-year process.
This reminds me of what they were telling the people in the UK, you know, when they were complaining, you know, that the grocery stores don't have to offer much products anymore, you know. They just said, you know, it is not a delivery problem. You know, it is that the shopping rooms are not too big.
It's not really a delivery problem. I got to thinking about that. You know, no, we'll mention that in a moment. But just getting back to it, the fact is, our society is capitalist and it's consumer driven. And so right now, they don't want to say that there's any inflation. You know, they want you out buying that Christmas present. They want you out spending that green stuff, filling up that Christmas stocking, you know, because all the rich people need to take a little piece of everything we buy because that's how they make their money. And if we don't buy stuff, they don't make any money because they don't work. So get out there, people, spend your money and feed the rich. It's your patriotic duty.
Yes. Yeah. How many days did the Black Friday cover this year? I think it was more than a week, right? You know, keep the people pushing to get presents and gifts.
I didn't see a lot of news, and that kind of tells me the one report I did see was that it didn't do very well. And so I don't think they're wanting to talk about the fact that people are kind of pushed to the limit, you know, and that we have a massive unemployment and that. Wages have gone up a little bit, but not even as much as inflation. So, and people have had to endure almost 2 years of the pandemic. Some people are flat ass broke. All right.
Yeah. Yes.
Let's be blunt about it. They got wiped out. They're done. And others are getting there. But, you know, the point is a lot of people are not thinking about putting a lot of stuff under the Christmas tree, you know, seeing friends and family and talking about personal issues and hugging is probably going to be the more. Well, you can't even do that though with the pandemic. Oh, Jesus, we're screwed.
Keith, but you pointed out that inflation isn't a figure that's based on an index of prices that are going up or down, and that is very, very true. The problem is that we measure this in a very, like, how we measure it, like what we assign the meaning of inflation is crucial. If we're going to have changes in our economy, that's inevitably going to affect prices of certain things. Like, for example, if more people, if growing meat becomes more costly because its effect on the environment, it's going to affect inflationary prices, but that may not necessarily be a bad thing as people move more into a more flexitarian diet, both for their health and for the sake of the animals and sake of the planet. So the picture of inflation is not everything. It's
right. Well, that's absolutely right, Mark. Amos, and one thing I got to say about that is, you know, the idea of what you were just talking about, the substitution of meat being, you know, that requires a working market. And I'm not sure that what we have are working markets. We've got markets that are controlled by, at this point, large monopolies called corporations. And they're kind of setting the prices the way they want to. A market, you know, has to be free, and there's really no such thing because monopolistic influences take over. You know, the capitalists claim they want a free market. Actually, the truth is they don't want a free market at all. They're always trying to get into a monopolistic situation where they can fix prices, you know, and for this particular segment, you know, the question is do the prices increases reflect real world conditions, or are they being just put in place because rich capitalists think they can go by with it? And at the end of this, I've made the conclusion that I do agree with left of left in that people are taking advantage of it. And the reason I say that is the way the markets work. You know, there's this whole complicated thing about price discovery. So you've got to like put a price out there, see if anybody wants it. And, you know, if you actually get into it, the way conventional markets work, they're not very efficient. And it's really better to have, you know, workers' councils and consumer councils deciding prices. But that's another story, isn't it? So, you know, that's what I wanted to say about that, Amos, because what you're talking about is an ideal world, and I agree with you, but that's not what's going on today. This world is anything but ideal. In the pandemic, yeah, the pandemic is the cause of inflation because it's setting the circumstances where the corporations can mark shit up because they can.
Yes.
Yeah, and part of the reason you know that's true is because everything's being blamed on trucking. Like all of a sudden, all the trucks rusted away and people started losing their licenses so they can't drive trucks anymore. Because 2 years ago, we had enough truck drivers and, you know, suddenly we got these huge supply chain issues. And that gets into another story. I looked into what a supply chain was, you know, and a supply chain is when you go to a foreign country where people don't have a right to, say, strike for better wages, and they're basically slave labor at a very low rate, and you put factories there, and the supply chain means that you ship stuff to the factory from overseas, like from the United States, to have something assembled using cheap labor, and then you send that back here in what are called free trade zones, where the free, they're called free because capital can move freely. You know, if people try to move freely, they got like 30-foot walls and sometimes machine guns and stuff. Ooh, that's, you know, but, you know, capital, that's what free trade is all about. People, it was a great con job on the American people when all these agreements were put in. So anyway, when they talk about a supply chain and everybody's smiling, oh, isn't it wonderful? It's actually what they're talking about is the system of exploitation where labor is being exploited all over the world. It's the result of neoliberal policies, and it's responsible for the mess we're in right now.
And look how short-sighted the complete capitalism's model is. Has developed at least, you know, if nobody is producing and storing their goods anymore, you know,
it is just in time.
It is also, yes, exactly, you know,
exactly.
And every transit, you know, is a period transit, where you can save cost, you know, to store stuff, you know. But the moment where a ship is not arriving or something is happening, this chain is interrupted, right? So it must continue. And if you have incidents happening like the coronavirus, like the crisis in the Suez Channel we saw, you know, which also had a lot of influence in this. So they are still working to get all the jobs finished, you know, which occurred from what happened there. You know, if this chain is broken, yes, you know, and if it is broken for hours, days, for weeks or months, what we saw with the virus, you know, because China was radical, you know, there was no ship to enter the harbors, you know, only I think only a few exceptions, you know, but China delivered all this stuff we Westerners urgently need to consume, right?
Right. Well, you know, it's a mistake to just point your finger at one thing and say this caused this, that, or that, you know. But yeah, it's, I think Naomi Klein wrote some book, what, Disaster Capitalism or something like that. You know, never waste a good opportunity to raise prices if you can. You know, increase your profit, get as much as you can. So, Yeah, it's a mix of things, you know. Sure, the coronavirus came along, closed ports, caused problems. But at the same time, the businesses, you know, logistic, they weren't planning on, oh, we got a problem. Let's plan things so that we don't have a big choke down 2 years from now when we have, you know, when we have the shipping mess we have now. See, part of what's going on now is very much a deliberate business decision, say, to cut back on, you know, on their use of the shipping, you know, cut back on production. And then, you know, the people that actually ship stuff figure that into their own business models. And so things are leading and lagging, and that's causing things to, you know, pile up in the ports. But, could that have been avoided? Oh, certainly it could have been avoided. You could have had a competent government, you know, put, you know, an agency, you know, a special group of people in there just to make sure that didn't happen. But that would be something like a New Deal situation, or, you know, we're talking serious government. Not, of course, but didn't Biden say he was doing that, though? I've tried all the options, or he's tried everything. I'm kidding.
What's important, though, since we're talking about inflation, is to set some things straight, because it is being used as a propagandic tool by the right, blaming inflation on the financial assistance to individuals during the pandemic, which is absolutely not the case. And if there was any effect, it was due to the billions of dollars that were thrown at private sector corporations. But not even that is true, because when you look at the facts, the world in its entirety is seeing inflation rates sky high. And if that was something specific to the United States and its policies, and in fact, the U.S. has done the least for the people in terms of financial assistance compared to
most supply chains cover the whole world.
Right. So that is what leads us to understand that it's not that blame that Republicans are trying to shift onto Biden as in terms of helping the people, and that's why all of this is going on. So we need to distinguish between that propaganda and what's going on. I just felt we needed to address that as well.
Yeah, you know, and we can move on to the next slide. That kind of emphasizes what you're trying to say there, Amos. You know, is the inflation rate a crystal ball for anything? No, it's not. And while corporations cry about pandemic inflation, corporation profits are at an all-time high. Is this true? Yes, it is. Profits are at an all-time high. So it's a mix.
And look, you also got to consider, you know, how much the consume did rise in the past decade or decades, you know. And there's also, you know, that every economy is putting their money on an ever-growing economy, right? And this, I think, this is the major mistake, right?
Well, capitalism has to grow. It's in the math of capitalism.
You know, yes, but we also know from capitalism that it has its up and downs, right? And the greed, you know, the greed is at maximum, you know. So we saw this when Trump gave the I don't know how many trillions, as you said, to the private sector and to the big companies, right?
So they could buy their own stock. Yeah,
it was one of the last grabs, you know. They know this, you know, and capitalism cannot be the solution, and I don't think that capitalism is able to correct its own mistakes, you know, because
I don't think it is. I think we need a revolution of some kind,
because the factor greed, you know, is the biggest number in this game, right?
Well, yes, greed and capitalism are joined at the hip.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that's it for all I want to say about the inflation today. You know, it was very interesting to go down the rabbit hole, find out what it is a little more, how it's measured, and what stories are being told about it. And So at the end, James is right. James from the internet's right. It's the corporations.
Yeah, he is. And you got a weather report with you, Keith, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay, let's go right into that. Yeah. I got a picture of a road, and that's Abbotsford, British Columbia. And in Seattle's about 150 miles south of where this is. So I'm 150 miles away from this picture. So I think that's me. I might even be closer. Anyway, Seattle is coming off its wettest month or wettest fall ever. And so we got like 19 inches of rain compared to a normal would be 11 at this time. So we almost have twice as much rain where, you know, the Pacific Northwest than what we normally have. And I found out this last Sunday myself. And so what happened was, my wife called me. She had been seeing some friends in Oregon, and she wanted to meet me on the seacoast. So she told me to meet her at the ocean. And so after our meeting, you know, last Sunday, I drove to the ocean. And Seattle's 125 miles. So anyway, from my house to where this happened was 200 kilometers. So picture this. It was a very bad drive for me. I've driven like over 100 miles through just driving rain. It's been dark. But, you know, last 50 miles or so, the weather has been pretty clear. It's fine, and I'm getting close to where I need to go. And I get right to I think it's Highway 109 I was on, a state highway. And I'm bombing down this road at 60 miles an hour. And let's this picture actually shows the road. And next, and I actually shows a picture of my car. Oh, go on to the next one there, Amos. Or are we on it? Are we showing number? Sorry, guys. 15.
15 is the next one.
I see.
Yeah. And we'll jump back and forth between this. I wanted to show the road. And so this is what the road looks like. But when I was there, okay, this is, you know, it's out. The largest, it's like 20, 30 miles away from the large city. And it's only like 7:30 at night or so, but it's pitch black. There's no streetlights. There's no other cars on the road. It's overcast. It's like, if I turned off the car lights, you would not be able to see the hand in front of your face. And and I'm going 60. And it's smooth, it's glossy, it's black, and I had no warning that this was going to happen. And all of a sudden, I hit water, and the car gets pulled to the right, and I know what to do because I learned to drive in snow, so I know how to handle a skid very well. And so, you know, the car is being pulled off the road to the right, so I you know, counter for that, and that causes some fishtailing. I counter that, and somehow I knew the best thing to do was to get through it. Or I didn't know where I was or what was going to, you know. Anyway, so through fishtailing water for about a few hundred feet, then I moved it, the car, to the center of the road, and then I got good traction and I was able to continue. And so, yeah, let's go. That's why I wanted to show the slide and show the road. And so you can really understand what it is I'm ranting about, because there is a point to all this, believe it or not. And this actually shows the location where I hit the water on the road. And if you look, there's a very nice drainage ditch on both sides of the road. It's a state route. So it's been there as is for, say, 100 years, not 100 years, maybe 80, right? And probably close to 100, actually. There may have been dirt road at that time. So anyway, it is at sea level. So the drainage, you know, what happened was it had rained so much earlier in the day that those drainage ditches filled up, and the water, at one point, the water was all the way across the road. And I had no warning of this. and actually understanding what was going on, I really wasn't in any danger. You know, Newton's law of motion means I would have gone in a straight line, you know, and you know, pretty much and just, you know, worst that would happen was I'd go into the drainage ditch, I suppose, and that would be very bad, but probably wouldn't be hurt too bad either. Anyway, it was much more of a panic, you know, I was much safer than I thought I was when suddenly I was driving in water. And anyway, yeah, so not as bad as what's going on in, you know, up in Canada. But let's just jump back to the last slide that shows where this happened. It shows the ocean, you know, and you can see a picture of my car there. And you also see the graph. And that's my point where, you know, we've got climate change going on, and even a couple of degrees of change in temperature centigrade actually does make a significant change in the amount of water that's going to be in the air. And so in the Pacific Northwest, are we seeing the climate effects of climate change by increased rain? We might be. I think we are. It's very interesting because on the way back from, it came back on Tuesday, and I'm driving back and I'm listening to National Petroleum Radio, you know, NPR. And, you know, at one time they were a great radio, you know, back when they had independence and a lot of money. But I think it was the Bush administration, the government, you know, really controls it. And they decided to turn it into a propaganda channel. And it still is. And so what they had a show and they were talking about, oh, it's El Nino. You see all this rain that we're having this. Here I am driving, you know, in home, heavy traffic. Yeah, it's all El Nino. And, you know, we're getting all these extra atmospheric rivers, they're calling them. They used to call it the Pineapple Express. But I guess the radar maps show that these moisture intrusions from the storms, they look like rivers. And so they changed the name. I kind of like Pineapple Express better. But anyway, so, you know, they said, but then they went on to say that, well, in the future, this could be what global warming could cause if we don't do something about it. And so, you know, it was a very clear propaganda message of, yes, there is a climate crisis, and yes, we really should do something about it, and let's get on that tomorrow.
I disagree that it's a propaganda message. I think there are certain elements of climate phenomena that are taking place that are not necessarily directly related to global warming, and it's important to kind of like distinguish between them. There's an institution.
Well, I agree with you, Amos. You know, and what would really support you is there really is a fact, there is El Nino. It does exist, and that certainly does affect things. However, the tone of the report, the tone was very much that what's happening now has nothing to do with global warming, when in fact we've already had 1 degree, you know, and we're on our way to 2, and we'll get there. And that, so, you know, yeah, I agree. You know, I can be, you know, kind of nuts myself if I just pretend that, you know, oh, they're just doing propaganda, doing nothing else. But there very much is a spin. And I'm seeing it everywhere. It's back to capitalism. My gosh, you can't have one. You know, last night, a couple of weeks ago, some crazy musician in Florida. She's a woman. She had to pee while she's giving her concert. And she had a guy come out of the audience and she peed on his face. And, you know, there was a short little video about this. And they had to work in economics somehow this was good for the economy. In this stupid report about this musician peeing on a guy's face in public.
How is it good for the economy?
But when it's good for the economy, then it's good for the economy, right?
Well, I guess everything is good for the economy. It must be. I mean, shit. Well, I wonder how much that'd be great for the economy, right? Take a poop.
I'm curious how they tied it in, but
grab your guitar, Keith. You know,
oh, hang on here. Yeah.
Find an audience
right now. Yeah. Okay, no, that's not my thing. Sorry, guys.
There is an institution. There's a project called the World Weather Attribution Project or initiative, and they're composed of scientists who are looking at each and every extreme weather event, and then trying to attribute it correctly. And it's just
you can't do that. Chaos theory says you can't do that.
Well, they can come very close because they can look.
Not really, because any given storm right now, you don't know if a butterfly flaps its wings 10 years ago, it would have changed the day of a storm now. Oh, and before, I'm sorry to interrupt you there, Amos, but I do want to point something out to Markus. You see my car up there?
Yes.
I drive a German Chevrolet.
I saw this. I saw this that you are driving a Mercedes, you know.
Yeah, it's a 2007 E350 or 350.
I got an old one. I think he is already 20 years old.
Well, mine's got less than 100,000 miles on it still.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but anyway, what I was saying is that it's important to attribute things based on the scientific look at them, even if they don't go along in each and every case with the narrative of global warming. And the recent case of that was when they analyzed the recent drought in Madagascar. They came to the conclusion that wasn't directly associated primarily with global climate change, but something that would have happened statistically at that point in any way. But the problem was that it affected their economy and their type of agriculture in such an extreme manner because of underlying problems with their infrastructure, and so the underlying point here is that it's important to determine objectively what is the main cause of each situation in order to address it more directly, even if there is a plethora of different areas that have to be addressed. So
yeah, I agree with what you're trying to say there, Amos. There's more to it, though. You know, in that one thing that's the world is changing. So you know, it's like it's not clear. It's not clear that you can always make the comparison.
All right. Shall we move over to yes? I outed myself in the green room before we started the show to have absolutely no knowledge anymore. You know, I was asking Amos, Andrew Yang, you are making a story about Andrew Yang. Why the hell? You know, by the way, is he still with the Democrats? You know, and then I learned, no, he left the Democrats, you know. And well, I'm absolutely new to this and I'm curious, Amos, what's going on with Andrew Yang?
All right. Well, see, he recently he ran for mayor in New York. He didn't make it. He quit before the end because it was clear that he wouldn't win. But he then afterwards quit the Democratic Party and he founded a new party called the Forward Party. The Forward Party is an interesting. Their slogan is forward, not left, not right. And so his approach here is to fix fundamental issues that are underlying with the American political system. And though I may not agree with Yang on his necessarily on his worldview, because I think he's more centrist than I am. But nevertheless, I think it's important to look at these things that this party is attempting to do.
Yes, I mean, sorry when I interrupt you. You mind if you look at that at a slogan, right? Not left, not right, forward. You know, if you're not left, not right, where are you? You are in the center, right? So yeah, go on.
Yes, please. And he definitely considers himself centrist. He considers the party to be in a centrist position. Nevertheless, their main focus here is to reduce polarization and to create an outlet so that the party system that is existing today cannot block other people, and in that sense it could be a progressive party, it could be a centrist party, it could be anything, but there's got to be a situation where an additional party can change the equation.
All right.
And so let me get into it and first of all mention the main principles of this party, and that is human-centered capitalism. Of course, he considers his position a capitalistic position. But human-centered means that it's not only attempting to look at capitalism as something that will benefit all of the constituents, but also measure the market in a way that is based on the effects on everybody, and we've talked about that as well. So I think while you don't agree with capitalism as a whole, Keith, I think that is still a leap from what we have right now, which is unfettered capitalism, pretty much, and a continually declining progressivism.
And the question would
I agree with that.
And the question also would be, when we want to plan to get rid of capitalism, right? What should it replace it? So, who has to deal with it? This are the people, right? And there must be some kind in between in the development to completely get rid of capitalism, my opinion. So it might be an interesting
thing. Like worker-owned co-ops, for instance?
Yes, could be an option. Yes, sounds interesting.
Yeah. He's not, like I said, he's not suggesting.
Richard Wolff says a lot about this,
right? He's not on the train of anti-capitalism, but nevertheless, some of these movements are, I think, in the right direction. The other principle is universal basic income, which he has been championing all along. It's Nixon's idea. Well, not his idea, but it was Nixon's project. It didn't happen. And the idea here is that you would provide basic income for every citizen, and it would be unrelated to their other income capability or income, basically, so that they would receive a certain base salary.
May I ask you at this point, what kind of universal basic income he has in mind? Because there is not one UBI, there are different UBIs, and there are also UBIs which you could classify to be completely capitalistic. So what UBI has he in mind?
Well, he has put a proposal when he was running for president in the primaries, and that was to provide every citizen with $1,000 just on top of whatever.
I wish I could talk to him. I tell him to go for carbon dividends. That's the way to set up a UBI. We don't have a UBI yet, but that could be the way to do it. Perhaps, so you give, yeah. It'd be a great way to do it, you know. Disagree. Then you've got everybody registered, everybody's getting a few hundred bucks, you know.
Okay. But what does he suggest? You know, does this mean, you know, if everyone would get $1,000 a month, right? Would this pay replace all other social security devices, or yes, what would happen?
That's the idea, that it would
replace. Then it's the neoliberal UBI income system, and this is bullshit. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, I kind of that's what I kind of think of Mr. Yang myself, but that's just me.
It is a libertarian idea. It is a libertarian idea. That's why Nixon was pushing it. So either way, but that's his belief, philosophy. That's his belief. That's why it's part of the principles. Fact-based governance.
So, honest question. When are you going to join?
What? The forward party?
Yeah.
Me?
Yeah.
I don't know if I necessarily will join or if I need to join, but I will cover that in a bit. But
okay, we can come back to it, because I got, yeah, you know, there's...
Let's almost continue, and then we'll talk about all of it, I think.
Yes. It's a fact-based governance, and that is where science becomes much more, and fact collection, data collection becomes much more centric to governance, as opposed to ideology, just going by strict ideology. That is something we have not seen in our politics, and that would be a welcome change in my belief. Effective and modern government, where you make government as efficient and as advanced as other private sector interfaces that exist. So that's kind of like, I guess that's aspirational. I don't know if they have specific ideas of how to achieve that. And of course, there's always complexity in delivering something on a scale that would require it to be if it was a government institution or government solution. And finally, the grace and tolerance in terms of addressing every citizen's position, and that, again, it's aspirational, that doesn't really mean much. But either way, now we're coming to the aspect of duopoly. And we've always complained about duopoly. Let's first let him talk here and explain what is the general problem that he's attempting to address with this party.
I wrote this book after I came off the presidential trail, Kim, and I was reflecting on both my journey and experiences and also why it's not working, why we're so stuck. And when I dug in, I realized that we're being set up to turn on each other, for polarization to get worse and worse. It's going to lead us to political violence and unrest. And so I dug deep and thought, how can we actually arrest this decline? How can we change the dynamic? And it requires a third party unifying movement that's inclusive of Democrats, independents, and Republicans who just want our system to work better, because our system right now is set up to turn us on each other and to fail.
So he's saying basically the system right now is kind of set up so that people on either side gain more by talking to the extreme voters, not necessarily to the central voters, and therefore it's creating more discourse, more problems than it is.
But that's no news. You know, we all know about this. You know, but what? Give us some meat to the bone.
So he's addressing the issue of duopoly and the evil of duopoly, and here's what he has to say about that.
And the fact is, right now, the support for an alternative to the duopoly is at 62%. It's a record high. Imagine if you arrived in a marketplace and 62% of people wanted an alternative. You'd offer that alternative. The problem is that the duopoly has set up the mechanics such that it's very difficult for any new party to emerge, libertarian, forward, you name it. So what we have to do is make common cause and change the mechanics to open primaries and ranked choice voting that would allow genuine political dynamism. The fact is the majority of Americans are for this. Independents outnumber Republicans or Democrats almost 2-1. We're being set up to fail by this creaking duopoly, and we have to change it as quickly as possible if we're going to have any chance of moving forward. No pun intended.
Yeah, so basically, I think that we could agree that our frustration here is that we cannot get anything done with the Democratic Party in this, in our case, in our view, that is hampered by a few, so to speak, moderates that are like dictating what is happening, and we're in a situation where everybody who joins that party is kind of forced to the middle, and so we've been railing against duopoly. Of course, not everybody who is not satisfied with duopoly believes that they should be in the center, so they could have very different perspective of where they want to go with the multi-party system. And finally, there's many countries where there's multi-party systems, and that doesn't necessarily by itself solve the issue. Like, look at Israel, Italy, places like that keep running into repeat elections and stuff because they have a dynamic that is just unsolvable even in the multi-party system. So I don't know if this is like a panacea, but I think our frustration at this point is such that we cannot get anything done within the Democratic Party as progressives, and therefore I think it would be a good move to create something more open. And he mentioned the strategy, which is having open primaries. That means that you're not limiting it only to people who registered Democrats or registered Republicans, so you allow much more openness in terms of selecting the candidates, and ranked choice voting, which has been implemented in New York, for example, in my opinion, with great success. And it allows you to vote for a number of candidates in a list. Like, first I want this one, second I want this one, third I want this one. And the person who wins is not necessarily the guy who has the least opposition. Is just the guy, the person who manages to be on more lists altogether. So it's a better system in terms of getting someone who you want to represent you. Here's his explanation on the strategy.
Because if you look at our Constitution, there's nothing about political parties. We're essentially living the worst nightmare of our founding fathers come to life. The duopoly, it was John Adams, I think he called it a great evil. And it was before it even happened in 1780. So the fact that this is all controlled at the state level is actually tremendously positive, because one state has already passed a ballot initiative to convert to open primaries and ranked choice voting, Alaska. There are 24 other states, as you just said, Kim, that we can do the same thing. So this is why, if enough of us get together, we can make this happen for real at the state level, as opposed to, frankly, bashing our head against a wall in Congress and waiting for them to fix the machine that is providing incentives that are making it so that they get rewarded for keeping issues around rather than solving problems and resolving them.
And this is the focus of this party, at least until 2022, which is very interesting, because he's putting the focus on actions on the state level, on the local state level, instead of the federal level. So he wants to change these primary elections to open them up and to create a ranked choice voting in a number of problematic states. And even if they manage to turn like a handful of these states in such a way that might affect the nature of the types of the representation those states have in Congress and in Senate, and that might have a significant impact on that goal. So it's a very interesting perspective, and they do not require whoever the candidates that they would be supporting do not have to be part of the forward party. You don't have to change affiliation. You just go in this direction and that's sufficient. So very interesting proposal. It's a little bit more, just another thing that he explains in this regard.
Because if you look at our Constitution, there's nothing about political parties. We're essentially living the worst nightmare of our founding fathers come to life. The duopoly.
Okay, that is the same clip.
Yeah. But,
all right. So basically, we spoke about their principles, but their principles as a party are less important than what the platform is. And in terms of the platform, they have they're promoting measuring the economic prosperity using a wider index that measures humans as well as monetary indicators. So instead of measuring everything as GDP or inflation or so forth, measuring how it impacts individuals and not just seeing them as part of, as input into the system, into the monetary system. They're also promoting support of a constitutional amendment that would limit individuals to a maximum of 18 years in each chamber of Congress, and that is to limit the effect of everybody's election. There's another a platform, a point that adopt rank choice voting system for elections that better capture the will of the majority of voters. That's what we mentioned. There's another one, adopt nonpartisan primary systems so that more people can participate in selecting the eventual general election candidates and thus have a voice in our country's leadership. That is the open
Keith, may you type a little bit not so loud? Thank you.
And then we have a couple of additional ones. Independent restricting of commissions. Voters should be choosing their representative rather than representative choosing their voters. So basically having the zoning, gerrymandering being abolished and instead it be moved to a commission that is nonpartisan. That would improve things tremendously. Fight the influence of mega donors in our elections and allow the voice of the people to be amplified by providing every American voter with $100 democracy dollars. And that is kind of similar to what was proposed in HR1, public matching funds or public funds that kind of help candidates not have to completely rely on big donors. I like that. There's another one, convene civic juries, which is an interesting concept, made up of representative groups of Americans to deliberate on key issues of legislation. So it wouldn't just be people in Congress deliberating the legislations, but people of all facets of society that would be able to contribute to framing the discussion and finally providing final feedback before it gets to the floor for voting. So you could see there's a bunch of really interesting concept. I'm very curious where he's going to take it from I am worried where we are heading if nothing changes on a fundamental structural level, which is what he's proposing, whether you like his worldview or not. And I am very, very concerned about the upcoming elections and how it's going to bode for democracy in the United States. It seemed like we're very firmly in the direction of losing our democracy, following some countries that have done that recently.
Yes. Well, as you say, there are some things which made me curious. I'm not convinced yet, as you say, you know, if, you know, I need to learn more about it, you know, but if you look, for example, you know, what I asked about UBI, you know, you got to look for the fine print if you want. So, you know, and, from what he says, from what is written there, it all sounds good. And one thing is for sure, you know, whether you like this new party, the new young party, Freedom Party or not, I think competition is always welcome. And in this two-class party system, we urgently need more parties added.
I'll ask a question now of Amos, though. Are you going to join the party? And what, if so, why? And if not, why? Just really quick.
Yeah, like I said, I think the fact that this approach is fundamentally looking to shift and change the way our system works, to me is by itself of great value, because I see our stuck state as a point of concern, and I'm afraid most of all I'm afraid of losing our democracy. If I am to have to take some things that I like and sacrifice them temporarily in order to move in such a better direction, I think I may be willing to do that. So that is my calculation here, that it's going to open possibilities. I think as much as I'd like someone progressive to represent the country and push the policies of this country forward, I think it's lacking the education, it's lacking the cultural background and the atmosphere for it at this time, and we have to think of it strategically in terms of building the structures first, building the pathways before we
that's what I was trying to squeeze out of you, that last part. I was really looking for a simple yes or no, but that took a while, but you finally got there, that there's something missing. And that's what I wanted to get out. You know, to me, I see this thing, and this is Andrew Yang's show, you know, and it's going to fail. This is, I can't see how this can possibly work. Okay. To make real change, What we got to do is what Amos suggested. A framework has to be set up, you know, so that here's the problem I want to get to, is you just can't make a third party and expect it to spring up and replace the duopoly. It's not going to happen. It can't happen. What we can do is we can make, like, get into discussion groups and get into small parties amongst ourselves. If you're a libertarian, find other libertarians. If you're socialist, find other socialists, whatever. Get together and start debating and working things out. Don't let an Andrew Yang come along and say, hold up a sign and say, join this party and do it, because then you won't do anything. You'll do absolutely nothing. You'll say, I'm a member of this party, and we believe in this, and we believe in that, and absolutely nothing will happen.
Yeah, but because Keith, everything that he's proposing here is actionable in terms of
no. Actually, what he's proposing is very idealistic and Oh, what's the word? Yeah, not utilitarian. It's beyond that. It's all theory. This is his personal show. See, it's not real world. We got it. And the reason it has to be done, because we have to create the base that you talked about a minute ago, where we have to create the social structure. And we're not going to do that without informed people, without an informed populace. How do you do that? You build it. And you build it in pieces, little pieces, and you put these big pieces together, these little pieces to make bigger pieces. And then you get a third party. It's the end of a result.
Right,
and all the little parties that started to create it, they lose their name. But the members and all those, they coalesce, and then we have something. But to expect anything to just show up magically, because I'm creating the Freedom Party, or next year we're going to be running candidates and so on. No. See, I see that this is Andrew Yang's show. He's representing his own personal philosophy, and that's all that's going on here, you know? And, you know, if we want change, people have to actually get involved and like,
it's
join something. Going out and meeting people, getting in groups, discussing, and going from there. You're finding out people, movements that are going on in your area that you want to support, and then helping those people and so on. But it's got to be built from the bottom up. And the reason is, amongst other things, is anything built from the top down, it's just going to fail because nobody can understand. We have to have the educated populace. We don't get that if we don't build from the bottom up. So Keith, that's my opinion on this.
Keith,
this is not a solution at all.
You are absolutely right, Keith. You know, I also share that a party should be built from the bottom up. The question is, in how far is there a demand in the American public, you know, for all those targets which he collected there in his party agenda? And because we also got to consider, not everyone is active. Not everyone is an activist, you know. There are millions of people, you know, who love to lean back and give the responsibility in other hands, you know. Just knowing is enough for them that they are supporting the correct way to do things, you know. You don't have to forget those people as well, right? And what I say, you know, from a political point of view, competition is absolutely needed. If Andrew Yang fails with this project, and if it is really the Andrew Yang show, what in parts looks like, to be honest, is a complete different matter, in my opinion. Most importantly is that Republicans and Democrats, most importantly, need, there is a competition emerging, right?
But Marcus, if we want change, ultimately some activists will be making that change. And the number of activists that are needed to create social change is only about 3% of the total population. So, you know, we don't have to have everyone being activists. That's, you're quite right. But the problem I see with something like the Freedom Party is, if you have that, then you don't have any activists, because then if people just join the Freedom Party and
the question things that happen. The question, the question is, you know, when we look back at when Bernie built his Bernie movement, right? Unfortunately, he never used it as he could, right? But he called the people to get active, you know. Is this, and there, I would like to ask Amos a question. Is there also the question from Andrew Yang, right, to get up finally from the couch and become active? Or is it enough for him that you register in his new party?
No, I think it's the former. I think that and to Keith, yeah, ideally you want everybody to be activists and do push things forward, and somehow
you only need 3%.
And somehow magically all be on the same page. The issue is that, like with Bernie, you gotta have somebody who draws a map, who draws a path that's doable, that's practical. And he's trying to do that with his proposal to run open primaries and ranked choice voting to bring it to the next stage. So even if he succeeds just with that thing, which I think we should support him on as progressives, because it's not in our interest to keep propagating the duopoly.
I support Bernie, but he's not enough. He's part of the system. He is a social democrat, and that's his.
Bernie is out of any discussion nowadays, yeah. In my opinion. He's not a topic anymore. It is sad, but it's a fact, in my opinion.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying is that...
He'll always wear mittens.
What I'm saying is that it's not a pie in the sky kind of like a thing that he's like just aspirationally talking about. He's putting a proposal that that has a strategy behind it. And I think it's worth looking for, and you don't have to become a follower of the party itself as in terms of its entire point of view or worldview, but supporting some of these elements that he's putting out there as fundamental changes to our democracy, to our system of governance, I think is something to consider.
You got to do more than put them out there. That's my point. It's just putting them out there is not going to accomplish anything.
Well, that will be in great part determined whether he gets a following or not. That's why I think it's important for all of us to understand and see what his attempts are, and then either cooperate on that or collaborate on that or not.
We'll see.
Interesting report.
We'll see. It was interesting because, well, Andrew Yang was not a name for me to keep in mind, right, after his run for presidency. And, let's see where it leads, you know, where it develops. And, I'm, as I said, I'm curious, but by far not convinced.
I can't hang with Yang.
All right. Maybe you can hang with the next guy. You know, this is, we talked about him last week when we had him in the short stories, you know, the grandiose speech he gave in front of the industry bosses. And to give you a nice intro rap song, let's go hit it, Matt.
If you live in the UK, I feel bad for you, son. We've got 99 problems and I can't fix one. We've got no petrol. You can't drive yourselves to the supermarket and it's empty shelves. But how can we have a shortage of gas when every word I say comes out my ass? If you have cheap energy deals, they'll be taken away, like free school meals or the 20 quid from Universal Credit. Because if you're poor, I don't give a shit. We'll care for the old by robbing the young. Some pay their share, but the rich ain't one. Lots of these problems were caused by Brexit, a self-destruct button. And yes, I pressed it. Leaving didn't have to be such a nightmare, but I did nothing to prepare. I've never done a hard day's work in my life. I missed COVID briefings to divorce my wife. Coronavirus. I totally fucked it. And alas, tens of thousands kicked the bucket. Tory party donors stuffed their pockets and didn't do enough to test, trace or stop it. I failed even the most basic task when I didn't ask you to still wear a mask. I act as if COVID-19's gone away. In fact, over 100 people die each day. If you're in the UK, I feel bad for you, son. We've got 99 problems and I'm number one.
Yes. Thank you, Cassette Boy. Yes, we're talking about the British number one. It's a prime minister. It's Boris Johnson. And I don't know why I'm so blurry, you know. Excuse, you know, this is my line from Germany, obviously.
It happens to the best of us.
The wind's blowing his hair all over the place.
I think you need vitamin D.
Yes. And, and here we are already in a Cork section, in a KYRC section, if you want so, because this is... This is news we will also have on Cork Radio. And for this purpose, I would like to introduce you to what's going on. And well, it's kingdom after Brexit. And the question which is raised is, are you okay, Prime Minister? Boris Johnson, the Prime Minister, embarrassed the UK in front of British industry bosses last week with a bizarre speech that culminated in an advertisement for Peppa Pig, a comic book pig for children. So let's have a closer look at what has been going on in the UK lately. Boris Johnson made a lot of promises to his voters, but now is unable to keep them. There is, for example, a major change coming in social care subsidies, which means nothing else than a deep cut into the budget. Though Johnson promised it would not cost people's homes, we see exactly how this is going to happen. This cut will save the government hundreds of millions of pounds, and it doesn't matter much to Johnson that mostly those with less valuable assets are affected by this. Another big promise of his was to take care of the north of England, which urgently needed help as this region was not much of political concern in the past. Johnson promised a full high-speed east-west railway, which, among other things, was supposed to link Manchester to Leeds. The project was called HS2. This is not going to happen, and Johnson's big plan turns out to be nothing more than an upgrade of the current railway system. This week came out, Johnson threw a party at number 10, last year in December, though it was strictly ordered by law not to attend meetings, parties, etc. at that time. For Johnson, of course, everything was okay, as he and his guests followed the rules, so was his comment. And most importantly, there is the migrant crisis that London has to deal with. As the British government shuts down legal ways to enter and ask for asylum, migrants try to come to England on tiny ships by themselves or with the help of human traffickers. 31 people drowned in the English Channel last week trying this very dangerous transit. As a reaction to this, the PM wrote an open letter to French President Emmanuel Macron, which he published on his Twitter account. In his letter, Johnson demands France to take back illegal immigrants which came across the Channel. The French government, which was ready to discuss solutions with the English side, was not amused by Johnson's publicity stunt, showed a harsh reaction to his tweet, and cancelled the meeting with his Minister for the Interior, Gérald Darmanin, and his British counterpart, Priti Patel. And what's going on with the people in England meanwhile? We see news about shortages everywhere. People queue up to get gas for their cars, and grocery stores put up wallpapers with prints of products they cannot offer anymore to give the impression everything is in order. But the people in the streets see that there is nothing in order anymore. Even those who advocated for British independence from the EU recognize that something is really seriously wrong on the island. The anger over Johnson is growing. And here may lie the reason for Boris Johnson's erratic behavior. By playing both the king and his own court jester, he still manages to distract the public from his failures to lead the country. The only question is, how long can this work for him until the British people have enough of his failed policies? All right. Well,
it's worked for a very long time. It might keep working.
Yes, but in his own party, in the Tory party, there are more and more people pissed about him. And I don't think that he will stay in office the complete term. He's completely under pressure. There's too many broken promises. I didn't even mention that he also promised to build 14 new hospitals in the UK. And it also, you know, when you look closely to what's going on, his ministers already said, you know, we don't have the money for this. And what's left is also only an upgrade of the current medical system, you know, and not what he promised, not what the Tories promised when they misled the people to vote for Brexit, etc. And the biggest the biggest joke, you know, the sad but biggest joke is, you know, that the supermarkets cannot help themselves, you know, then putting up wallpapers and showing products, you know, they can't offer anymore, you know. And I said it earlier on the show, when this topic comes up, you know, Tory ministers react like this. You know, they're saying it is not a problem that we have not enough products to offer. The sales rooms are so big. You know, it's a complete travesty of what's going on there. You know, and well, the sad part is really. That what's going on in the channel, but we come to this a little bit later. Let's listen quickly to a Guardian interview. You know, he gave, you know, when he was announcing that the budget for Northern England Railway cannot be done. You know, look what he said.
And what we're doing is levelling up across the country by giving people in the Midlands and in the North the kind of commuter type services that people have been accustomed to in the South East.
You've broken your promises to people here, no. Pledges on Leeds to no. Manchester. Do you think, you know, you're cutting, you promised Northern Powerhouse Rail between Leeds and Manchester, and you're talking about speed, not capacity. Do you think people in the North are stupid?
You're talking total rubbish, because we're doubling capacity between Manchester and Leeds.
But you're cutting capacity on what it would have been.
We're trebling capacity between Liverpool and Manchester. And of course, Christian, there are going to be people who's, you know, who always want everything at once.
There are yes. always this people is, this with is, everything at once.
This is also one quality Boris Johnson definitely has. You know, he has a talent to not answer a single question. You know, which is raised to him, and it is absolutely crazy. And there you see the next video shows a debate. It was last week. The new leader of the Labour Party, Keir Starmer, addressed Boris Johnson about his party activities 1 year ago.
As millions of people were locked down last year, was a Christmas party thrown in Downing Street for dozens of people on December the 18th?
Prime Minister!
Mr. Speaker, what I can tell the Right Honourable Gentleman is that all guidance was followed completely during Number 10. And can I recommend to the Right Honourable Gentleman that he does the same with his own Christmas party, which he's advertised for December the 15th, to which unaccountably he's failed to invite the Deputy Leader, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister says we should concentrate on what he's asking the country to do. We're asking the country to follow the rules. Yep. Now, the Prime Minister doesn't deny there was a Downing Street Christmas party last year. He's not denied it. He says no rules were broken. Both of those things can't be true, Prime Minister. He's taking the British public for fools. And as for following the rules, Prime Minister, it might be good just to look behind you when it comes to the question of masks. As ever, one rule for them, another rule for everybody else.
Yes, and this is, as we learned, another quality the Tories have, you know. I did not even mention all the corruption affairs which came up in the past month. It is a complete disaster, you know, and Boris Johnson is nothing else as the master of disaster, you know. And when he gave the interview, the railway interview, don't you think he doesn't know that he looks terribly stupid with his helmet and the yellow vest? He knows it, but this is exactly the effects he counts on, you know, that people, you know, I'm only sharing how stupid he looks, you know, but completely forget what this guy lies about, right?
Root for Trump.
And where he came to where he crossed a red line was last week, and this is a very tragic topic, you know, because here you know, not far away from Germany in the channel over to Great Britain, people are dying, you know. I don't know why they are fleeing to the United Kingdom. I don't see any reason to go to this country, you know, at the moment. But okay, they might have their reasons and they urgently go there, you know. And as they have no legal way to get there, they're trying this on their own. And it is adventurous, you know, which ways they are trying, you know. And
right.
As we learned, 31 people drowned last week in the channel. And what Johnson did, you know, he came up public with demands to France. And you got to see, you got to consider the situation France is right now. Next year in France are the big elections. And Emmanuel Macron is under deep, deep pressure, not from one right-winger side, but from two, meanwhile. And he still showed readiness to discuss solutions with the English side, you know, about how to solve this problem, you know, how to avoid that people drown there, you know. And the only guy Boris Johnson could count on was Emmanuel Macron. And what does he do? He is threatening Emmanuel Macron to take back the illegal immigrants. And here's the reaction of Emmanuel Macron.
I am surprised by methods that aren't serious. We do not communicate from one leader to another by tweets and letters on these issues. We don't throw warnings around. Come on. Come on. So ministers will work seriously to deal with a serious issue with serious people. That's why on Sunday, Minister Darmanin will meet with his counterparts from the European Union and the Commission to work on this issue. And then we'll see how we can work with the British on how to respond effectively, if they decide to be serious.
I'd like to help with that. Yes. Marcus, I've looked it up. And first thing we have to do is we have to translate illegal immigrant or illegal alien into French. And I did it. It's called a migrant.
Okay. Well, you can see that. I mean, Emmanuel Macron used very, very clear words. There was no diplomacy anymore in it, you know. In contrary, he labeled the British government, and especially Boris Johnson, as being not someone who is really interested in the topic, not someone who can be taken serious. And this is a hit right on the nose if you wanna talk in diplomatic language. Emmanuel Macron is super pissed, to say it in other words, right? I'm not a friend of him, but you know, the charades Boris Johnson and his cronies are playing also around the agreements with Brexit. I don't go into details right now, don't worry. You know, it is, I think it was the red line. And now solutions are trying to find solutions now within the circle of the European members. Great Britain is not any longer a member, at least the United Kingdom. And they have no say anymore, you know. And that is the other bitter lesson they have to learn. They can cry, they can shout, they can do whatever they want. They threw away the chance, you know, to have any influence on what the European Union does. And well, that's it, you know. And this is one of the things which is reality now for the UK, and it doesn't look good, you know. And I didn't even mention what's going on with the virus, right? And yeah.
Well, Macron may be pissed, but I bet he doesn't know who Peppa Pig is.
he doesn't know now. The world knows who Peppa Pig is now. And maybe Boris Johnson gets some advertisement money.
Kickback.
Piggy bank, yeah. All right. That was my part. So let's go over to the satire lineup. And I think this is a topic. What do you think, guys? How will it end? Yeah,
I don't know. Like a while ago, we were being told that no way they're gonna touch an enshrined precedents like Roe versus Wade, and here we are. They're just about said that they're ready to abolish that. They could surprise us, but it's unlikely. I think that's where they're going. And once they do that, it's going to be clear that that it's a partisan or ideological decision and not one based on precedents, because it contradicts many decisions that the Supreme Court has supported in the past. So if that principle of stare decisis is going to be held, I think we're going to see a complete abandonment of anybody's trust in the Supreme Court as an independent non-partisan structure.
Well, we had a report earlier about that Andrew Yang's political party, and we were mentioning activists and so on. And it looks like the next few weeks, months, the Supreme Court could give us cause to take to the streets and demand something, a few things. I would say so.
Well, they're not democratically elected. They're not a representational institution. So
no, but their decisions can be overridden if Congress gets enough votes. You know, I'm not sure the exact procedure, but so people hitting the streets and being activists and demanding that there be a change, and whatever the Supreme Court does gets reversed, would actually be useful. It would actually cause the duopoly to rise to the occasion. But then again, this is a great distraction to make people really concerned about stuff that does matter. Oh yeah, if you're a young woman, certainly this matters. But from the point of view of the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer, does this matter? No. So it'll be a great distraction. So I'm not sure how it's going to play out. It could go either way. But regardless, there are going to be a lot of people that are going to be very upset, very pissed, rightly so, and they will be making a lot of noise.
Definitely. Yeah.
And I will help.
Let's go to Sister Amy, She says the abortion problem would be solved through adoptions, and if you look at the foot mat in front of her door, it says unwelcome.
Let her adopt all of the unaborted children. So
yeah,
but I thought one of the points of abortion was it kept children from being raised by bad mothers.
Yeah,
like Emmy.
Yeah. Well, in parts of honestly, parts of the country, from my perspective from abroad, there is not much different, with a religious Islamic fundamentalist in parts, and what we are seeing there in America, also with religion, also with abortion and stuff, it is, for me as a German, where we don't have to deal with this problem, in contrary, it is absolutely outlandish, if you want so, right?
Yeah, well, that's a very good analogy. Yeah, Sharia law is very much like the fundamentalist Christian doctrines. In fact, I recall coming across a reference to the Plymouth Rock Colony, or one of the early colonies in the eastern United States, was the people that founded it were religious fanatics, just like somebody who believes in Sharia law and all that stuff. And now we have at least one of them on the Supreme Court, a fanatic.
Yeah. Damn it. What we are talking about, right?
Yep.
Let's go to the next one. And I was not sure if I should put this up, you know, because this is a very embarrassing cartoon for myself, to be honest. You know, that you see the tattoo on the elephant's fat ass, you know, Marjorie Taylor Greene, you know.
Yep.
You know, people who are
I love it. Get rid of that tattoo.
You cannot take people serious, you know, who have politicians' tattoos on their body, you know, only to say it like this.
One of my, you know, I can never imagine getting the name of, say, a girlfriend or you know, on myself, because they leave you. What you're gonna do?
Yeah, the other question is, do you have
to find
skin?
Another one with the same name.
Good point. Having enough skin could be an issue. Yeah.
Yeah, more serious, it's here, you know, protect school kids, ban books, right? To Kill a Mockingbird. Yeah, there's kill in the title. Of course, you cannot tolerate this. Yeah. And, you know, I don't understand all the criticism, you know, all the fuss around COVID, you know, those who deny that it exists, you know. I mean, you all watch the Transformer bullshit stuff in the movies, right? You know how it works.
A great cartoon.
Yeah. Don't they look a little bit like there was a lot of incest involved in this? I don't know. Yes, and this is the other thing, you know. The fear, you know, and the fear is fed with Omicron, right?
I have to say, though,
What,
Amos, what do you want to say about Omicron?
Not about Omicron, but as much as everybody likes to beat on Fauci, he's not been propagating hysteria and fear. On the contrary,
no. This is not how I interpret this. You know, this is the general fear. You know, and finally, before we started the show, you know. They don't know anything at the moment how to deal with Omicron. They are still in the testing phases, you know. And I only can advise, be careful, you know, until we know something for sure, right?
Yeah, but
know for sure it's in Los Angeles.
Yeah, and what I read, and this is also a little bit worrying, but you got to be careful with the numbers. I read yesterday an article that. They found, I think, about 12 or 20 people infected with Omicron, and they said that half of them were double vaccinated. But this number is not confirmed yet, so be careful. I don't want to spread any rumors. But this shows, you know, that the scientists are still trying to decode what it really is, right? And how dangerous it could be. And this is a virus, I think Amos said it last week, with 31 or 32 mutations. You know, we don't know if it is the end version. You know, what about the next version with 64 or something like that, right?
Yeah, well, 32 on the spike, part.
Yeah,
of it.
On the spike, yeah.
Yeah, which
yeah, I read an interesting thing where the claim was made that it developed in one person with a weakened immune system. So this person was incubating kind of like a living Petri dish for like a year. And that's why it has so many the mutations, because it came from, you know, one person who incubated it through all this time.
Right. Yeah. And even though we don't have final results regarding the escape aspect from vaccine, it comes to reason that if the spike protein is so different than what it was in the previous variants, if you're basing your vaccine solely on the spike, which all of the Western types of, even Johnson & Johnson, they're all basing it on the spike protein. If everything's based on that, it's not going to work very well. So that much we know, and we know that the R number for the contagion strength of this virus. So in these two fields, it's not promising. On the term, on in terms of the severity of the outcome, we may be lucky with that, but we don't know yet.
Yeah,
we're phased. We have to see what happens in the next few weeks. But
yeah. But finally, there's one good thing, because things are getting back to normal. Ah, yeah, this is the other tragedy, you know, there's, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the tragically normal, if you want so, right?
They call that the Stockholm syndrome, I think.
Yeah, damn it.
Something like that.
All right. We are at the end of our show. It's our last show on this platform, guys. What do you say?
In this format.
Well, it will say no. It won't be the last show, but
is there another last show coming?
Well, last one at least in this format,
and on this channel,
there will be a change.
Yes, and we, of course, we go on, as we said at the beginning, you know, you will find us on Mixcloud, you will get information on YouTube where we are, you will get the direct link to the show if you want to be with us when we're doing the live show, and well, you can find us also in the future on KORC 105.9 FM, and well, we are looking forward to see you soon, and please give us a little bit time, you know, to get reorganized, that we get things reformatted, etc., and you know all this stuff, you know, but we are not going completely away, right?
Yeah, it might take us a little bit of time to ramp up in the new way of doing things.
Yeah, we've got to mention things again. I just see we've got sharp canines saying what, why in our chat.
Oh,
and, right. You know, it's been 2 hours since we said what was going on, so I'll just recapitulate for the new people.
No, Keith, just watch the beginning of the roll back to the beginning.
Okay,
of
watch the beginning.
Go back right to the beginning, and there is the announcement, and we are going to the radio if you want to.
Okay, and the benefit is you can listen to it live online. You could just listen to it as radio. You can enjoy the music and
yes. When we are done with the show in a few minutes, you can directly go to Cork and, listen in. All right. Thank you, guys. It was a pleasure again for me to be with you, to do this. And we will make it short. We go out. We didn't talk much about the virus today, only the cartoons in the end. But I would like to bring on Mark Rebellet and his vaccinated attitude. And this guy is just hilarious. He is a solo artist, and he's from New York, and he looks a little bit like Johnny Depp, but he's much, much better, at least in music. And you will see it right now. So far, have a great week. Have a great weekend. Stay safe, and see you soon.
Bye, guys. Bye-bye.
Well, I see this Pfizer Moderna, I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine up inside my Got the vaccine up inside my life. I got the vaccine and I'm feeling just right. Yeah, vaccine in my motherfucking dick. Got the vaccine and I'm gonna suck you clear. I got the vaccine Moderna, I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine.
Got that motherfucking vaccine.
Moderna, I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine.
Got the motherfucking
Moderna. I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got the vaccine up inside my Pfizer Moderna. I got got the vaccine. I got that motherfucking pill. Come on, baby, got the vaccine. I said I got the vaccine. It's a new lease on life, baby. Skipping down the damn street, no thing. I'm taking a little spit in the mouth, spit in the dick, spit in my ass, spit on your tits. Rubbing it around, getting down in this motherfucking baby. Got a vaccinated attitude, and I'm gonna rock and roll. I put the dick in the hole. Rock and roll, I put the dick in the hole. When I'm a Moderna, I got the vaccine. You know what I'm talking about? Moderna. I got the vaccine. Hey, yo, we're motherfucking clean. I'm clean. I'm motherfucking clean with my vaccine. Yo, how you doing, baby? You got it?
I got my damn vaccine an hour ago. I got the second dose. You got it. You have to wait 14 days, though, so it's going to be... I mean, I know it's kind of cool. You just saw me on the street, and I just got my vaccine, and you're vaccinated, but we got to wait. There's a gestation period, so it's...
Oh, there's... So we can't... We can just fuck on the... On the street? That's the old vaccinated song. Feeling good, feeling nice, and vaxxed up, bitch. I'm vaxxed. Damn, bitch, what you vaxxed? Damn, you looking vaxxed.